Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Abu Saleh, an assistant professor of English at the Raja Parimohan College under University of Calcutta. Now we'll be doing a module on John Milton, and special focus will be on his poems and themes of his writings and legacies of John Milton. This module is part of the paper English Literature 1592-1798. And this module is been prepared by Mr. Sagir Ali, who is an assistant professor of English at Midnapur College, West Bengal. Now, let us discuss the module in detail. It would be very sketchy and incomplete and invitably unsatisfactory effort to suggest a comprehensive idea of the achievements of the gigantic creator like John Milton within the space of question and answer. We may start with the observation that Milton was a polymath in the true sense of the term, and his creative impetus was a combination of herbalism, Hellenism, and Renaissance humanism. Chiefly celebrated as a great poet, he also left his unique contribution to the English tragedy and to English prose. Here, in this module, Milton, his poems and legacies have been elaborately discussed. John Milton's lifespan ranges from 1608 to 1674. He was born on December 9, 1608 into a prosperous bourgeois family. He was educated at St. Paul's School in London and later Christ College, Cambridge. From 1641, he gave up poetry for prose polemics or for the sake of Puritan causes. He was a Protestant, and from his childhood, he disliked the religious policy of King Charles. John Milton was a roundhead. The Cavaliers, the Royalists, supported the king and tended towards Catholicism. Milton believed in aristocracy that had the right to special privileges, both in politics and in religion. The Roundheads, or the Puritans, believed in a wider distribution of political and economic power and the right of every man to enjoy direct access to God. Milton was strongly committed to the Puritan cause, that he accepted a government position under Oliver Cromwell, who ruled as Lord Protector from 1649 to 1658. Milton was a radical Christian individualist who objected strongly and vocally to all kinds of organized religions, which he believed put barriers between man and God. Milton was therefore a rebel because he identified himself with a revolutionary cause. His father was a scrivener, a sort of combined notary and banker, who was wealthy enough to afford private tutors for his son. Then, schooling at St. Paul's and Christ College under Cambridge University, Milton was educated in these places. Perhaps just as important for Milton's development was the fact that his father was a musician and composer. One of the most attractive features of Milton's poetry is its marvelous musical qualities. Since Milton had a small private income, he did not seek a profession when he left Cambridge, but stayed at home and started writing poetry. It is to be said that Milton is one of the most learned men of that time. Milton wrote poetry in Latin, Greek, and Italian, and read almost all the literature surviving from Greek and Roman periods. He even read the Bible in its original, in the Hebrew language. Just before the religious and political quarrels in England came to a head, Milton went abroad for 15 months, meeting and talking with learned and famous men all over Europe. He met Galileo, looked through his telescope, and a fact Milton mentions more than once in Paradise Lost. When he returned, he puts his learning and considerably rhetorical force at the service of Puritan cause. He wrote a series of scorching political and religious pamphlets. He condemned bishops, not only the Catholic ones, but those the Protestant churches of England. Defended the liberty of press against censorship. The Civil War deeply affected his personal relations. His brother, Christopher, adhered to the royalist side. Milton married into a royalist family in 1642. Milton was one of the last great liberal intelligence of English Renaissance. The values expressed in all his works are the values of tolerance, freedom, and self-determination. Milton's early poems from the 1620s to 1630s include several which remain as the model of their kind. El Allegro and Il Penseroso are companion pieces advocating and contrasting styles of life and therefore and the studios. Of his sonnets, On His Blindness is perhaps the best known. With its last line, they also serve who only stand and wait. Lycidas is one of the most quoted elegies in English, moving from its commemoration of his Cambridge University friend Edward King, to reflection on the writer's own morality and ambitions, finishing the remarkable optimism of renewal of the with the words, "Weep no more, woeful shepherds, weep no more, for Lycidas, your sorrow is not dead." Like all Milton works, Lycidas has been interpreted as specifically Christian. Such a reading can be supported by the poet's ambition to join the church by many explicitly Christian references in his writings. But his beliefs go beyond any single doctrine, as can be seen from the wide range of political and social pamphlets he wrote between 1640 and 1650. A time when he wrote only a few poems. Milton's prose can be related to the writings of Browne and Burton, with the major difference that Milton engages in polemic as well as touching upon philosophical concerns. It was a time when a great many of the issues which had arisen since the Reformation came to a head and freedom were questioned as never before. It was no accident that Milton's first polemic pamphlet was entitled Of Reformation in England and the Causes That Hitherto Have Hindered It, which came in 1641. Milton has addressed such varieties of subjects as divorce, education, and famously the freedom of the press. In Areopagitica in 1644, Milton continued to defend his ideals of freedom and republicanism. But at the Restoration, by which time he was arrested. Various powerful contacts allowed him to be released after paying a fine, and his remaining years were devoted to the composition orally in the form of dictation to his third wife, or his epic poem, The Fall of Humanity, Paradise Lost, which was published in 1667. Now let us discuss about Milton, Paradise Lost in short. Milton was attracted to the Arthurian legends as the subject for his great epic. But the theme of the fall of man from heaven goes far beyond a national epic and gave the poet scope to analyze the whole question of freedom, free will, and individual choice. He attempted to rationalize the spirit of the Renaissance in his epic. Paradise Lost explains an entire theology. It is about the coming of sin into the world through temptation of Adam and Eve by Satan after his defeat in heaven. If Milton has justified the ways of God to man, all our questions about relationship to God should be answered by the implication from the poem. The success of this explanation, of course, depends on whether you accept the Christian world view, even whether you accept Milton's special brand of Christian individualism. The task of explaining an entire physical and moral system is not one we attempt today. We divide our systems believing that the world is too complex for a single theory to explain. Paradise Lost is probably the only epic to incorporate the celestial descent into a larger and indeed a comprehensive pattern of imagery, a pattern which includes a poem's two major events, the fall of Saturn and of Adam. Milton interweaves those events into a fabric of multitudinous references to height and depth, rising and falling, which appear on virtually every page and bind every incident of the narrative into a closer unity, sometimes witty, sometimes ironic, sometimes simple and transparent, appearing now in an epithet, a phrase, a smiley, as well as in the sweeping lines of the action, as subtle workings of the pattern turn incessantly a moral or metaphysical mirror upon objective events, and covertly translate moral events into spatial terms. Paradise Lost plays continually with the paradoxical duality of lowness, the lowness of humanity and moral degradation of despair, and with the duality of hate, of spirituality, eminence or exaltation, and of pride. It plays also with the paradoxes of rising and falling, the abasement that exalts the pride and abases. When Adam and Eve fall prostrate to the ground, confessing their sin with tears in humiliation meek, their prayers rise successfully to heaven. When the sun orders to descend and a mortal body, he is correspondingly elevated. So after discussing Paradise Lost, now let us discuss a little of Paradise Regained. Despite its title, Paradise Regained does not assert the idea that the redemption of humankind hinges on Christ's resistance to temptation in the wilderness. Though a job-like patent submission and the will of God is clearly a dominant theme, Milton's Samson Agonistes, which is a verse drama, and Paradise Regained, a sequel in four books to Paradise Lost, were both published in 1671, 4 years after Paradise Lost. Both the works show a different conception of the hero from the ambiguous interplay between God, man, and Satan, which were found in Paradise Lost. The fundamental difference between Adam and Eve in Paradise Lost and the heroes of other two poems, the former probably written during the Commonwealth, the latter nearer the end of Milton's life, is humanity. Both Samson and Christ are superhuman, indeed beyond the bounds of normal human beings. As such, their triumphs and conquests are less clearly explorations of human qualities. As Samson destroys the Philistines in their temple, or as Jesus Christ repels the temptation of Satan, they lack the element of human identification. Milton returns to the theme of blindness in some of the darkest lines of English poetry, as Samson describes his being exiled from the light, which we can find in the poem Samson Agonist. The great bulk of Milton's poetry was written during two periods separated from each other by 20 years. The first period is his university career and his stay at Houghton from 1629 to 1640, and the next period is latter years of his life from about 1660 to 1674. The years between were filled by few sonnets. While still an undergraduate Milton began to compose poems of remarkable maturity and promise. They include the fine and stately ode on the morning of Christ's nativity, which came in 1629, and the poems on Shakespeare, which was published in 1630, and on arriving the age of 23, which came in 1631. While at Horton, he composed El Allegro and Il Penseroso, two long poems in octosyllabic couplets dealing with the respective experience of that gay and thoughtful man. The pieces are decorative rather than descriptive, artificial rather than natural, but they are full of scholarly fancy and adroit poetical fencing. Camus, which was published in 1634, belongs to this period and is a mask. Camus is a mask containing some stiff but beautiful blank verse of some quite charming lyrical measures. Lycidas was published in 1637, which is an elegy for his friend Edward King, who was drowned on a voyage to Ireland. The real subject of the poem, however, is the uncertainty and torment occasioned in Milton's mind by his realization that death might forestall the achievement and the fame which was his ambition. In its varying moods, we see the interplay of doubt, fear, anger, and finally a peaceful reliance on the belief that true fame rests on God and is only to be found in heaven. It is his underlying subject that gives the poem a passionate sincerity. Lycidas, which is to be reckoned as among the highest of Milton's achievements, is something quite new in English literature, or especially in English poetry. In form, it is a pastoral, but an artificial medium serves only to show the power of Milton's grief and the essence of poetry. This elegy has a colorful and music of the best of Spenserian verse, but it has a climbing majesty of epithet and a dignified intensity of passion that Spenser does not possess. The name Lycidas is taken from the Greek bacchic poet Theocritus, and distant but distinctly echoes of classical pastoral poetry which run through Milton's elegy. Its form, however, is that of an English adaptation of current Italian canzone, a form which gave Milton the freedom of to vary both the structure in his verse paragraphs and the length of his lines. The elegy blends elements from the pagan and the Christian and intermixes God and saints, nymphs and angels. It mirrors the contemporary idea of revealed Christianity as the enlightened extension of aspects of pagan spirituality by moving from a grieving and almost stoic acceptance of loss of an assertion of sure certain hope that Christian resurrection. The Orcop Midilliers is composed of few sonnets. These, with some others written at different times, sufficiently show Milton's command of Italian form, which he uses throughout. Milton gives it a sweep and sonorous impressiveness that set him alone beside Wordsworth, who in his respect is his poetical successor. The best of Milton's sonnets are On His Blindness and The Late Masarche of Piedmont. The great work of his time is Paradise Lost. At first, it was divided into 10 books or 10 parts, but in the second edition, it was redivided into 12 books. In form of it follows the strict unity of the classical epic, and in theme, it deals with the fall of man from heaven. But by means, it introduced narratives. It covers the rebellion of Lucifer in heaven, the celestial warfare, and the expulsion of the rebels. In conception, A poem is spacious and commanding. It is Milton's rich imagination, fed with classical and biblical lore, which suggest the characters, especially that of Lucifer, are drawn on a gigantic scale and do not lack the certain tragic immensity. And the blank verse in which the work is composed is new and wonderful. This type of blank verse has founded the tradition in English. It has often imitated and modified and tried later, but it was never paralleled with Milton. Milton's tragedy, Samson Agonistes, subjects is essentially appropriate to both phases in Milton's career. For Samson Agonistes seeks to adopt the form of Greek tragedy to the needs of a Christian society and to equate Hebrew moral to the faith of a Protestant elect. The drama closely follows both classical models and the prescriptions of classical critics. Unlike the English tragedies, Milton's immediate forebears and contemporaries, it adheres faithfully to the unities of time, place, and accent. It places considerable weight on its chorus of Dantes, and it traces the growth of enlightenment of its protagonist. Samson's slow enlightenment drives him not to despair, but to reconciliation to the beginning purposes of God. His death is seen not as a purging, but a triumph in which chorus is finally brought to an awareness of the hero's dearly bought revenge, yet glorious. Samson, as a type of Christ, prefigures the Messiah's redemption death, mastering defeat through a submission to the will of God. Truly, liberty of Milton's biblically based works imply rest in the resolved and independent understanding of the nature of service. The influence of an author or others can be direct and subtle, or widespread or local, in many venues or few, but John Milton, it has long been demonstrated that he has been and still is one whose influence has been direct and subtle, widespread and also concentrated in specific years and locales, in literature, art and music, and in religious knowledge, political theory and social thinking. Current conscience of struggles between good and evil in the world has led to such a movie as The Devil's Advocate, where the main character is called John Milton, and the Satan as clever fellow interpretation of his epic poem Paradise Lost pervades. Terroristic world action, particularly for religious reasons, has brought Milton's dramatic poem Samson Agonistes before the public seeking understanding of suicide bombers, with a reading of Samson's destructions of the Philistines as his condoning of jihad. The great advances of science and space travel, which a movie such as the first Matrix exploits, have reminded viewers of Saturn's voyage in Paradise Lost through chaos, and later his circling the equinox three times, crossing the meridians of longitude four times, and returning to Earth on the eighth day. The blind Neo has thus been seen as a counterpart of Milton. Wordsworth's 55 poems written in blank verse show a direct influence to Paradise Lost. Another great romantic poet who considered Milton as his master and persuaded him in his literary career is Shelley. Shelley used Milton's style and verse in many of his poems. Milton was obviously a great model for him. In the opinion of Shelley, Milton is to be associated with the greatest names in poetry, such as Homer, Virgil, Dante, and of course William Shakespeare. He places Milton as the greatest poet after Shakespeare in the English language and literature. Shelley read Milton's works for many times so he got well acquainted with his art. As a result of his continuous reading, eventually Shelley was more influenced by Milton than by any other English poet. Pope's The Dunciad frequently imitates and has allusions to Milton's Paradise Lost. There are lots of similarities between both the works. For instance, Cibber in Dunciad plays the roles of Christ and Adam. Saturn is associated with several figures in the Dunciad, such as Bentley, Linton, the Deist, and of course the narrator. Nathaniel Evans is one of the Milton's American admirers and imitators. Even small volume Poems on Several Occasions, published in 1772, contains at least 6 poems which are definitely imitations of Milton poems. To sum up this module, we can say that in this module we have shown Milton, how Milton was a great metrical artist who used a number of meters and bars form with a great art and skill. His early poetry reveals his masterly over and use of rhyme. His later poems, including Paradise Lost, brings out his skill in the handling of blank verse as well as his mastery in the treatment of great themes in with gigantic loftiness. So in this module we have learnt about John Milton, especially his poems, his styles of writing, and his legacies of his poetry and his literary career. We have seen how Milton has influenced other young and junior writers throughout the time. So if you want to know more about John Milton, his poems, his legacies, please read the e-text of this module. Also, you can have a look of the or the further reading of this section, where we have listed several books and articles which will lead to you further study of John Milton. Also, you can participate in the self-assessment. Thank you.